Each morning for worship here at Knox Walkerton, we begin our service of worship by lighting the candle of Christ. And we do this, of course, to remind ourselves and to remind each other that Jesus Christ is the light of the world. And the light shines in the darkness. But the darkness did not overcome it. Please join me in our call to worship for this morning. The mighty one, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting.
God shines forth. God comes and does not keep silence.
He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people.
Gather to me, my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice.
He has shown the people the power of his words and has given them the heritage of the nations. The heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge.
Amen.
Amen. Our first hymn for this morning is hymn number 371, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Please stand if you're able.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Welcome, everyone, this morning to Knox Walkerton Presbyterian Church. I hope you're all doing well this morning. We just have a couple of announcements for this morning. Some important things coming up. Of course, this Monday, tomorrow, we have our community dinner. That's a monthly thing. And if you volunteered to help out, hopefully you received an email from me. If not, you can just take me aside and say, hey, where's my email? But I think I got back to everyone, and I'll be sending out the task list today after worship. And that's from 5 o'clock to 6:30 p.m. If you have a volunteer but you want to come to the dinner, you can. It's free. Invite anyone you want to. We also have our annual meeting coming up next Sunday, February 18th, so you can plan accordingly for that. You have your annual report in your inbox, either physical copy in your inbox back there in the narthex, or if you requested it, you should have a digital copy in your email inbox. And so you have your annual reports to look over and read, and then next week we're going to be having our annual meeting. And that's going to be taking place downstairs instead of up here. So worship and everything will be downstairs rather than upstairs next week only. And for our online viewers, everyone at home, that will be streamed but only in part. And so there will be Facebook Live only for the early portion of worship, including the message. And then afterwards, for the rest of the annual meeting, it will not be recorded. And so, yeah, you can plan accordingly for that. Our Burns Night Dinner was well attended and enjoyed by all who were there. Thanks to several people who donated items to the dinner, plus the hard work of our wonderful volunteers, we were able to earn a profit of $1,775.38 to help support our budget. Well done, everyone. And then there's a Christmas shoebox. What's that? Oh, sorry. Hey, quiet up there. We have a Christmas shoebox update. There were 11,330,126 shoeboxes packed worldwide. Yeah, that wouldn't be very many if it was 11,000. That would be a very underwhelming amount. Over 11 million shoeboxes packed worldwide. Ontario donated 154,229 of those shoeboxes. So we were a part of that operation. 41C containers were shipped from Canada, and boxes from Canada went to West Africa, Central America, Eastern Europe, and Southeast Asia. So that's great to hear. We also have had some volunteers cleaning out our resource room. And you can see on the back of your bulletin here, it says free Christian VHS tapes. And so if you have any need of VHS tapes, or you know someone who does, we no longer own a VCR, and we have but we do still have a bunch of the tapes, and we don't know what to do with them. If you have any ideas, if you have anyone you know who needs VHS tapes, please feel free to take them. They're free. They're located in the pass-through from the church hall to the choir room that's downstairs. And so that's just, when we get around to cleaning things up, we find all sorts of stuff packed away in the church. And then we're going to have a Zoom event, a Come Together WMS Zoom event on February 14th this week from 1 to 2:30 p.m. in the Shaw Room. The guest speaker is Reverend, is that pronounced Nikki Ashwin? Yeah. She'll be speaking on the topic, not on our watch. A Caribbean native, her passion for justice, particularly gender justice, is rooted in memories of systematic and tacitly accepted domestic abuse normalized by cultural art forms that sometimes denigrated women and men in jest. And so that should be an interesting time. Check out those our announcements. I think I covered everything there. My brothers and sisters in Christ, let's come together in prayer. Let us pray. God Almighty, we come before you today in humble adoration. We worship you because you are our creator, our sustainer, our redeemer, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord, as we come before you, as we approach you, we pray that you be beside us. Lord, we know that you walk with us every step of our way in this journey of life. You walk beside us so that when we stumble and when we fall, you might be there to support us. You might be there to pick us up. Lord, we know that we do not always act as we should act, that we do not always behave as we should behave, that we do things that we should not do, and we do not do the things we should. For that, we ask forgiveness. We are grateful, Lord, because you offer that forgiveness to us freely. You pick us up and we continue on our way. And for that, we are eternally grateful. Dear Lord, do not leave our side, but remain beside us as we continue to walk in this life. All these things we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so, my brothers and sisters, I say to you that just as surely as Jesus Christ died and was risen on the third day, just as surely your sins are forgiven you. And I say to you, the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please greet your neighbor with the peace of Christ. You've got plenty of room over there. What's up, guys? All right. Fair enough. I said, what's up? He says, the roof. That's a very smart answer. What about the sky? The clouds? The sun? What's that? That's up above the roof. I know. That's even higher up than the roof. Yeah. How's it going? How's your week?
Good.
How's school? Yeah? Nice boots? Your sister is not here to bring them to you, so you had to wear them off, eh? That's good. All right, so we're doing okay this morning, obviously. I keep asking this, but no more snow days, no more fog days, no nothing, eh? That's good, that's good. Well, today, this week, do you know what this Sunday is? What were you going to say? It's church? Yeah. Close. That's coming up. That's coming up. But this Sunday is it actually has a name. It's a big word. No, it's not Good Friday. It's not Pancake Tuesday. No, no, it's not. It's called It's Sunday Sunday? No, it's not Palm Sunday. No, no. It's not Christmas either. It's called, today is called Transfiguration Sunday. You didn't know that? I didn't think so. That's okay, though. We don't talk about it very often. You have a very confused look on your face. The word is long to remember? That's okay. You don't have to remember it. I'll remember it for you. It is church day. That is true. It's called Transfiguration Sunday. I know it's a long word. Can you repeat it one time? Transfiguration? Only one time, guys. That's fine. You're good. You think he's cuckoo? That's not very nice. Do you hear that, Dorian? She thinks you're cuckoo. No? You don't think so? A bit more cuckoo? Okay. But anyways, yeah, so it's a big word, but it means like transformation. Okay, it's another word for transformation. And what happened was Jesus said to some of his friends, he was like, hey guys, follow me up this mountain. And so they walked up into a mountain, right? And then Jesus got them up on the mountain, him and a couple of his buddies, and then he transformed. He turned into, well, he like changed colors. He turned all bright light, and he turned different colors and stuff, and it was crazy. It was a crazy time. He became what? And so it's a really weird story, but the story is really Jesus. You know, Jesus walked around and he was just a regular guy, right? But when he took his friends up into the mountain, he was showing them how close he was to God, right? And that he was hiding something underneath, you know, his normal appearance, right? And in a certain way, we're all kind of like that. We have a little bit of God inside of us. And the way that we can show that to other people, we can't exactly transform like Jesus, but we can show that to other people through things like kindness and through things like love, right? What's that?
Hugs,
yes. But you got to ask first. You got to say, hey, are you okay with a hug? Right? You just jump on your friends and give them hugs. Okay, you do you. I know sometimes some people aren't too big on hugs, you know, and that's okay. You can show kindness in other ways. But if your friends are okay with hugs, then that's all right. Then you can hug them. That's fine. But yeah. And so I just wanted to share with you guys that it's Transfiguration Sunday. And if you don't remember that word by next week, then you don't get the prize. What's the prize, though? It's a new pair of shoes. No, I'm kidding. There's no prize.
I'm not remembering the what now.
What's that?
I'm not remembering the what now.
Because there's no prize?
No.
That's okay.
You said there would be prize, and then you said no.
Maybe I'll bring something. What do you like? You like chocolate bars? Chocolate? Yeah? Yeah? That's a pretty good bet. You want pine cones? I can get you lots of those. I can get you all sorts of pine cones. Chocolate pine cones. No, just pine cones dipped in chocolate. How does that sound? Bella, would you like that? This sounds tasty, doesn't it? No. Okay. Yeah, so just remember, guys, Jesus reminded us on Transfiguration Sunday. Jesus reminds us that we all have a little bit of God inside of us and that we can show that to others through our kindness and our love. And if it's consensual, through hugs and things like that. Why don't we say a quick prayer, guys? Do what you do when you pray. And repeat after me, okay? Dear God, thank you.
For showing us
on Transfiguration Sunday.
On Transfiguration Sunday.
There you go, you said it. Good job.
That we
have a bit of God in us. And
help us
to share that with others. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, folks. All right, our reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 to 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. And then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." And he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This story is one of the ones, as I was preparing, it's one of the first ones that I vividly remember preaching it the previous year now. So I've been here a year, and I remember talking about this last year on Transfiguration Sunday. And I was thinking to myself, what else is there to say about this story? There's not a whole lot, and because it's a very specific story. And at first glance, there's not a whole lot to teach about, right? Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up the mountain. That's, you know, Peter, the fisherman, James and John, also fishermen, brothers. These three guys are kind of the inner circle of Jesus. And he takes them up the mountain, seemingly for the purpose of doing this whole transfiguration routine. And what happens is Jesus is, as the word says, you know, transfigured. He becomes different in appearance, seemingly through light, His clothes become white, as it says, you know, like no one on earth could bleach them. Moses and Elijah show up, two guys from the Old Testament, and they're talking with Jesus. And then Peter does this thing. Peter is well known often for action. Peter always wants to do the right thing. Peter always wants to do something. And so he says, okay, we got to do something. This is a big deal. Jesus is here with Elijah and Moses. This is a big deal. Because Elijah and Moses were a big deal at the time to the Jewish people. Why? Well, Moses, you know, led the Israelites out of the desert. And he represents the law, right? Because if you've seen the movie, he brings the law down from the mountain. So he represents the law. And then Elijah was God's prophet. And so he represents prophecy. And so you've got the representatives of God's law and the prophets of God there with Jesus. And so what Peter does is he says, wow, this is great. We've got these three great men of God appearing here before us. Let's build dwellings for them. And what does that mean? He's making dwellings, three dwellings, one for you, Jesus, one for Moses, one for Elijah. Three dwellings. It's kind of like three monuments, three altars, like altars to a god. He wants to commemorate the occasion. But the mistake that he's making, what he's doing, is he's equating Jesus with the other two, Moses and Elijah, Jesus with the law, and Jesus with the prophet. But the truth is that the law and prophecy are subordinate to Jesus. And so that's why God appears suddenly. A cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. And then suddenly all the grand imagery disappears, and it's just Jesus again. Just Jesus. So what's happening here? Oftentimes, we tend to make things out to be Jesus, make things out to be God that are not God, that are not Jesus. We make this mistake. And the things that we mistake for God, the things that we mistake for Jesus, sometimes they can be important things in their own right. There is a great deal of importance in something like the law of God, in something like prophecy. But God's message to his disciples on this day, Transfiguration Day, is to say that even these things, as important as they are subordinate to my son, Jesus Christ. Because as soon as Peter says, okay, let's build these dwelling places for you, Jesus, for Elijah, for Moses, let's build these three dwelling places, essentially equating all three, immediately God's voice comes down and sets the record straight, so to speak, and then, boom, Moses and Elijah are gone, and it's just Jesus. Because it is just Jesus. And the message that Jesus brings is the message that we need to clear the playing field in order to hear. Get everything else out of our head. What's the thing, if you were to say within yourself, or the things that are static, that are keeping you from hearing the message of Jesus? What are the things, and I'm not saying it for you, you don't have to raise your hand and say, well, it's, But if you were to say within yourself, if you were to be honest with yourself, I'm sure there is something that you are holding at equal value with God, and maybe you're not realizing it. Maybe you do. But sometimes we need to be honest with ourselves and realize that there are things that we hold on par with God because we can't help it. We're human beings. And we often need to return to the mountain so that God can remind us, listen to him, listen to the Son, listen to the Beloved. Clear your mind, clear your soul. Get things straightened out. We all need to do that once in a while. We all need to go up into the mountain and remind ourselves of what's really important. You know, for me, I can often think that, well, certain experiences in my life, I sort of hold up as being very important. And I think these experiences, it's not that the experiences keep me from experiencing God, but the way that I relate to those experiences keep me from being closer to God and being closer to Jesus. I often talk about, hopefully not too often, but sometimes I talk about my experience of losing my brother when I was very young. It was a very important experience in my life, and I think, you know, I bring it into the pulpit when I can, when it's appropriate, because I think it helps in some instances to illustrate certain things that are important. When I was a kid, my brother died in a car accident. It's a defining moment in my life. And that's important. But sometimes I can take that experience and I can turn it into an idol in its own right. And it can cloud my judgment. I know that sounds kind of strange, but it happens. When I was a teenager, I had an English class with an English teacher that I didn't, it's not that I didn't like him, but he and I didn't quite see eye to eye, and we didn't always get along, right? And so one day we were talking about something, I forget what the topic was, or what like the book was, or the short story that we were talking about. But his question to the class was, you know, isn't there someone in your life that you would do anything for? Like a brother or a sister? And he singled me out and he said, Byron, wouldn't you do anything for your brother or sister? And I said, well, no, because my brother's dead. What can I do for my brother? And the whole class went, oh, you know, like, oh, you stepped in it, Mr. DeGoo. His name was Mr. DeGoo. And I felt very proud of myself because I got to do that to him. I got to make him feel awkward in that moment by using an experience of pain of my own so that he almost had no recourse, right? He had no way of walking it back. He had kind of fallen into a trap, right? And I remember in the moment feeling very good because I knew he was trying to single me out because, you know, I often would not be paying attention and he would ask me questions because he knew I wasn't paying attention. He wanted me to kind of squirm in my seat. And I had that moment. I was like, oh, I got you. But it wasn't a good thing to do. It wasn't a very nice thing to do. It was actually a very mean thing to do, right? why would I use this experience of my own, this experience of pain, to make someone else feel bad about themselves? And so afterwards, I felt very bad. And my point is, sometimes there are things in our lives, things that we hold dear, things that we value, and our relationship to those things can be such that we can use them to harm others. We can use them to miss the point. And that's the point. That's what sin means in the Bible. A lot of people make a big deal about sin. Sin just means missing the point. It's an archery term, actually. It means missing the mark. So the original word for sin was hamartia. It was a Greek word. And it just means, you know, if you shoot an arrow and you miss the bullseye, it's called missing the mark. So when I, you know, used my own brother's passing as a way to make my English teacher feel bad, that was sin. That was missing the mark, right? I was misunderstanding what I was supposed to take away from that experience. And so Peter, in this transfiguration moment, misses the point of what he's supposed to take away from his experience. He sees Jesus, he sees Moses, he sees Elijah, and he says, oh great, now we've got the whole gang here, and we can make dwelling places for all three of you, and we'll be good to go. But God has to remind him of what's really important. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. We often forget that Jesus is something pretty radical. We kind of lose it through the mists of time. It's been 2,000 years. It's hard to keep in touch with the incredible nature of what Jesus represents. But what Jesus represents is love. What Jesus represents is compassion. What Jesus represents is not trying to be antagonistic with others and trying to get one over on the other person like I tried to get over on my English teacher. Going so far as to use my own experience of pain to make him feel pain, right? That's just petty. It's nonsensical. But we do things like this. Of course, the disciples don't understand. Jesus tells his disciples, tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man rises up from the dead. And it goes on to say they kept the matter to themselves, but continuing to question what this rising from the dead could mean. They don't get the point of what's going on. And often we don't either. But that's okay. We're learning. And we'll continue to learn our whole lives. That process doesn't end. But on this Transfiguration Sunday, let's take a lesson from this story. Let's be reminded of what Jesus represents, that God walks near to us, and that he calls us to a higher form of living. He calls us to a deeper kindness than we might call ourselves to. It's a deeper kindness. Because oftentimes we can make ourselves feel good in the moment by being cruel. We're going to pay for it. We can make ourselves feel good in the moment, forgetting who God really is in Jesus Christ. Let's not forget it. Let's not walk down that path, because it can be a painful one. We can often regret it. So remember what Christ represents to us. Let's remember that God is near. God with us, Emmanuel. Amen. It's important to remember that God is a refuge for us, a dwelling place that we can hide in and be safe. And so let our next hymn remind us of that. And please stand if you are able to sing with us, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," number 316. You know, we come together in this place from all different walks of life, from all different understandings, from all different places. But when we come together here, we like to remind ourselves or remind each other of what we believe in, what common ground we hold. And so I would invite you to join me in repeating the Apostles' Creed to remind ourselves and each other of what we believe as a Christian people. Please join me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so at this time now, I would invite you to join me in singing our offering hymn, our offering doxology, as your offering is received. Please stand and join me. Let us pray. God Almighty, we bring before you this sacrifice of offering. We pray that it be acceptable in your sight and that you might bless it in your Son's holy name. Lord, we pray that these offerings might go towards the further work of your church. And we understand that work is to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ in this world. The many things that that might mean. Lord, help us always to keep before us that goal. Help us always to remember that Jesus calls us not to complacency, but to servanthood. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please sit. Let us pray. God Almighty, we've come before you today. We have worshiped you. We have sung your praises. We have prayed to you. We have heard your scriptures read aloud and contemplated your word, who is Jesus Christ. And now, Lord, we come before you in prayer once again in order to lift those prayers up to you, to beg that you might hear them as we consider those who need you now. We lift up to you the names and the faces of people who are struggling in this time, people who do not have food to eat, who do not have a roof over their head, people who do not have peace in their lives, those who are hungry, those who are lost, those who are grieving. We pray for those who are lonely, those who are afraid. We pray for those here in this community, close at hand, and those far away, in other towns, other cities, other countries. We pray for those who do not enjoy the peace that we enjoy here in this country. Pray for those in places like Ukraine and Gaza. We pray for peace in this world. We pray for an end to hunger, an end to darkness. Lord, we pray that your light shine in this world. In this time, hear our prayers. Lord, all these things that we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who more than 2,000 years ago was born into this world, born among we human beings, who was raised among us, who lived in our midst, walked with us and talked with us, and ate with us and drank with us, who laughed with us and cried with us, and who taught us many things, including how to pray that very special prayer which we pray now as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn, and please join us, stand if you are able, is Lord, the light of your love is shining. Shine, Jesus, shine, number 376. There's going to be some food downstairs, and so before I do the benediction, let's just say a quick prayer of grace. Father, we pray that you might bless the food that we are about to eat, and it may strengthen and nourish our bodies and our minds as our fellowship with you and with each other strengthens and nourishes our soul. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And now, as you go from this place, go with the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. May these things go with you and be with you from now until the end of time. Amen.